please welcome the CEO of New Tales, Cedric Marechal, the co-founder and CEO of Carry First, Cordel Robbin-Coker, head of publishing at DreamHaven, Paul della, director of studio relations and sourcing at KRAFTON, Young Kim, and our moderator and partner at BITKRAFT, Jin Oh.
Well, hello everyone. Thanks for sticking by. I know we're the last panel before dinner, which is a tough spot to be in, but we'll make it worthwhile. So we're talking about publishing today. I'm personally excited for two reasons. First, I spent a decent amount of time in publishing. And secondly, I think we have a fantastic panel here, some of whom are my ex-colleagues. So very excited to talk about publishing. So I'll set this up a little bit, with a bit of context why we're having this panel. In the last several years, especially with the pandemic, there's been a lot of investments going into the video game industry, right? So our hypothesis is that in the next coming years, there are going to be a lot of games and a lot of products that's going to be launched into games. Thus, we thought that there could be potentially a renaissance of publishing, right? So we may or may not be correct. So we wanted to test with the experts in the field, okay? So I'm going to sort of try to take us with a definition of what publishing is and go to trends and issues and end with some advice and suggestions, okay? Before we do that, let's have our panel introduce themselves. Cedric, you want to go first?
Yeah, thank you, Jin. So I'm Cedric Marechal. I'm the CEO and co-founder of New Tales, and I've been in the gaming industry since a little while, since 1993, always on the publishing side, and I spent quite a significant amount of my time at Blizzard during 20 years, handling regional operations. And now we are growing New Tales, so it's a new publisher and developer, and we are especially focusing on being a game operator for international game development and a community development house.
I'm Cordel Robbin-Coker. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Carry First. Carry First is Africa's leading game publisher. We're focused on publishing third-party games, and we also have an embedded fintech platform that allows for better, more effective alternative payments locally.
And I'm Paul della, currently head of publishing at DreamHaven. Previous to that, I worked at Blizzard Entertainment, Riot Games, did a couple of startups, but predominantly have been on the publishing side my entire career. Currently at DreamHaven, we're actually developing our own games internally, but we're also building the capabilities to be able to publish them globally. And we're also looking to help other developers be able to take their games to market and support the players that surround those games globally as well.
So my name is Young Kim. I'm the director of studio relations and sourcing, which means that I look out for investments, mostly in North America. You might be wondering why I'm at the publishing panel, but half of my career it was in the publishing department, helping out launch our MMORPG, also working on Terra, so I was mostly on the publishing and business side of that. I'm part of KRAFTON. As mentioned, the biggest game that we have is PUBG, and we try to be active in terms of publishing and also investments.
So when we selected the panel, other than them really having a deep experience in publishing, we also thought it was really interesting to have Cedric from Europe, Cordel representing Africa, Paul, North America, then and Young, Asia as well. So we thought hopefully we could get some diverse views. So let's start off with a definition of publishing, right? For us who've been in publishing, it's a really hard topic because everybody defines publishing in a very different way. So we'll go around, at least start, set the tone of what it is, and everybody may have a different version of it. So feel free to jump in. Let's start with you, Cedric.
Okay, like we were discussing, yeah, it's very difficult to define. So the way we look at publishing for us at New Tales is a link between content and players. And the role of publishing is to maximize game reach, to serve players around the world in the best possible manner, meaning you need to adapt your strategy to the different markets. and then to be the voice of the player and to analyze data in order to maximize your content and feedback to the content creator about how to tweak their content for the long run. So I think ultimately, the role of publishing is to maximize ROI and performance of a game.
Anybody else want to jump in?
I think the one thing I would add, to some people, I describe publishing as kind of the business arm of a game. Developing a game is this sort of beautiful mix of art and science, but at some point, to go from a beautiful piece of art to a thriving business, you need to get it into people's hands and you need to figure out how to make a bit of money. So I think publishing is really what encompasses that.
Makes sense.
Yeah, I could just add a little because I think that there's also that localization, but more importantly, internationalization of games, where publishing can really help developers understand how to meaningfully enter new markets that really resonates with the communities and the players in those markets in a really authentic way, and then also how to support them authentically once you're there and make sure that they know you're investing the time to integrate themselves with your culture and to really speak the language, not just literally. So.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and for us, it's a business about selling games and also making the game available and visible to the public, the target audience, and maybe even beyond. But that's the business of publishing. And that is the reason why a publisher has to be very honest, very realistic, talking about the market conditions and also what's sustainable for their business. So that's what I think publishing is.
Yeah, absolutely. I think as we talked about here, is publishing is really beyond just bringing the game to the players. It's really engaging them for the long time. And what publishing also does is it really magnifies the impact of games that we bring to the gamers as well, right? So since we sort of laid the groundwork of what publishing is, let's talk about sort of the differences in publishing for different platforms, right? With Avon and mobile, publishing has changed quite a bit. So Cordel, I know you've thought a lot about this. If you could sort of talk about what are some of the differences you see in mobile publishing versus PC and console?
I think one of the biggest differences is how you're able to reach the player. I think mobile with Google and Apple in particular, there really is an intermediary that creates a little bit of separation with regard to your ability to really engage players directly. And so I think that's one big difference. I think paid user acquisition tends to be more of a necessity in mobile, whereas PC and console, different organic strategies oftentimes can allow you to scale a game to very, very significant heights. So it's different. I actually think mobile publishing is the hardest. And I think in certain realms, folks can think that that they may as well do it themselves. But obviously we believe that there's some value, particularly regionally, to having a partner.
Makes sense. Anybody else wants to add?
Mobile publishing to me is more like data science, very focused on data analysis. Mm. You have to make sure that the game is just because like you have a few distribution partners, platforms that you have to work with, you have to be really extra careful of how you see data and how to analyze that. And that's very important compared to PC or console publishing. On the other side, like PC and console, I think it allows for more creative freedom, much more slower pace. So that's a reason why we see that like original IPs, PC and console platforms have more like possibilities to like foster original IPs compared to like mobile, the mobile environment.
Yeah, that makes sense. I think that what you said also ties well with Cordel, which makes mobile publishing quite difficult, as it seems more formulaic, yet it makes it a lot more difficult as well. So let's talk about sort of the trends and the issues and the changes that are happening in publishing quite a bit, right? So let's talk about that before we go into whether it's a renaissance or not. Paul, you wanna jump in? Some of the observations that you see?
Yeah, I think you could go a lot of different ways with this one, but since we're at this event, I think with all of the new startups that are coming up that have received equity backing, there's an opportunity for a different style of publisher to come out of that, where it's more of a co-publishing relationship that allows the development studios to take the money that they've raised and to really just focus on making the best game possible with that money. And then going out and finding a really strong publishing partner to help them take that game to market and kind of split responsibilities. And what I mean by that is, like, you always want the developer to have a direct relationship with the players that are playing their game. And so you really can't give that to anyone. It's one of the most important things that you can do is have that direct relationship, and the most authentic communication is going to come out of a development studio. But it would be really hard for them to scale that globally to reach all of their audiences, and it would require a very large team, a lot of resources, and so finding a strong partner that can help you scale and reach different markets outside of your native language or where you're developing is going to be really important. And it's something where a lot of those teams are going to want to go out and raise to face further dilution to be able to have that impact and that reach.
Sense. You want to jump
in? Yeah, maybe to add to that, I think, when you look at the market, since we have this number we always look at on our side, it's since 2015, the gaming market has been multiplied by two, globally speaking. So you go from 100 billion to 200 billion. It's amazing, and it's, fueling a lot of opportunities. A lot of new regions are growing. You have mobile. So lots of opportunities at the same time. To build on what PDB is saying, there is more and more content release. We were discussing about that just before. Since 2015, during the same time frame, the number of new game releases has been multiplied by 4 to 5. Mm-hmm. So there is an intensity in terms of competition. There are 40 new games per day being released on PC and console. So I think this is calling for a higher level of preparation, higher level of sophistication in the way you build your publishing plan. Because you need to emerge from the crowd, you need to win at a global scale, and this is requiring a lot of tools, a lot of partners, and a lot of complexity in everything you are preparing.
Makes sense. Anybody else want to jump in? Good. Go ahead, Yang.
The most obvious thing is that you can self-publish now, like compared to like 10 or 20 years ago. There's so many options in terms of publishing. You don't even need to work with a publisher. But I think we can discuss more later on, but exactly the reason why you want to consult with the publisher as well, because they have the experience, they have the knowledge. Even more important than the knowledge is experience. So you can Google anything, like basically you can ask ChatGPT about how to do publishing. Everybody knows about that. But having the experience is what makes it different. So I think that's the biggest thing that's different nowadays. Like, you can self-publish, and that's another option that you have.
Mm. Yeah. I was going to say, one very recent trend, right? Capital markets do go up and they go down, and capital's more and less available. With the ability to self-publish and with sort of an abundance of capital, you had a lot of folks basically deciding to go at it alone and wanting to experiment. And what we're starting to see in the last 18 months or so is people being a lot more judicious about where they spend that dollar, right? They want to spend it on building a great game, not necessarily on doing UA testing or experimenting for the first time. And so we actually see some folks coming back to the idea of third-party publishing in particular. It used to be a publishers would help you finish your game, right? They would be essentially your capital partner to build, and then would mean that you could scale without having to have a huge balance sheet. And we see some of that come back with the appetite for third-party publishing.
Interesting. And a lot of, and then Paul, is that okay?
Yeah, sure. Now, something I wanted to mention, if you step back, is that you had the first phase in publishing where studio and content creator had to go to see publisher originally in the 90s and early 2000s. It was box distribution. So publishers were actually essentially doing box distribution. Then you had all the digital platform coming, and many people were self-publishing, or I would say self-distributing their game. Now, with the intensity of you know, that we were mentioning of competition and with the world becoming even more complex from a gaming landscape, I think the publishing renaissance is back, and there is a need of having this level of expertise to maximize your chance of success when you release new content and a new IP, and when you want to build communities on the long run across the world. Yeah. It's a lot of effort that needs to be put, and it's a lot of... either you build it internally, but it takes a lot of time, or you go to third-party publishing because effectively you have already infrastructures that are built by other companies that you can use.
Makes sense. Paul, want to jump in?
Yeah, I just wanted to reinforce a point that Cordel made, which was that because they're not necessarily publishers, are no longer really need to be your capital partner, although they can provide some capital. The deal terms have changed in the favor of the developer. Like, you really don't see anyone giving up their IP, which used to be standard, in the old days of publishing. And we've also seen the economic shift to be more favorable for the developer as well. So that could be part of that renaissance where it's like forcing everyone to reevaluate just the whole deal structure of publishing in our industry, especially in the Western markets. And it's fortunately more advantageous for those developers that are in the space.
Good news for a lot of the startups out here, huh? Bad for you, but good for them, huh? Cedric?
Maybe to add to that, there is also a stronger integration between publishers and studios or content creators versus what it was in the past, because now you are in a digital, social, ongoing content delivery environment. It's very data-driven. You need to optimize your content, so... The loop between analyzing the content and the performance and the developer and the publisher relationship now is not even two companies. Most of the time we speak about co-publishing because you work as one team to deliver great content to players. So it's a very different way of working versus how it used to be previously.
Yeah, that makes sense. So I think we alluded to it. So our hypothesis, right, is that there will be a renaissance, and Cedric mentioned a lot of the games that are coming out. Yet the counter argument could be, but it's so much easier to publish, right? You got the app stores, Steam is stronger than ever. Why do you really need publishers, right? So numbers show it, but on the other side, you could argue it's a lot more efficient market. So I'd love to hear your perspective. Is there going to be a renaissance for publishing, or are we not? And maybe, Young, you want to start?
Yeah, I think so. There's going to be a renaissance of publishing. The way people publish, it's definitely going to be different depending on how the market changes. But we see that there are a lot of invested games, especially the past 2-3 years, that are going to come out soon and maybe for the next 2-3 years. So there's going to be so many games that will be in need of publishers, and it's going to change. They will have the option to choose whether to self-publish or find a publisher. But if they do, I hope they really try to engage with the publisher early on. Like, even if you are early stage, you should talk to different publishers because they are very different. Like, let's say we have this IP called PUBG. If it was like published by Activision, would it look the same? No, it will never be the same. If we like published Call of Duty, would it look the same? No, never. So you have to understand, you have to do your homework, understand what they are good at, understand what they will be driving, what they will be driving for you. And that's the reason why you do have to do your homework. And again, like even if you do decide to self-publish, there are also other areas that the publishers can really provide, like understanding different laws in different countries, their cultural sensitivity. I can list so many examples of where we were able to find that only through our like experiences that this is culturally fit or whether this is not. So that's usually more understood by the publisher. So you have to, I think, people depending on publishers, that's still going to be a very viable option for them.
Makes sense.
Yeah, I totally agree in both the renaissance, but also I think that's one of the things that, in addition to what Jung was saying, because those platforms and mobile has allowed so many developers to create games, there's more technologies that are allowing that as well. It's really hard to find games and to stand out in the crowd. And that's one thing that a publisher can really help you do, whether it's optimizing your presence on the storefronts that you have to leverage to distribute your game, or just really knowing how to communicate with the market that you know is going to be interested in your game. Like, it's not like you can just do these like television commercial blasts anymore to everybody. You really have to have a nuanced message to the core player base that's really you think is going to enjoy your game first, and then let them evangelize it for you after that moment. So we definitely think that there's a lot that a publisher could provide for these new companies.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And one point I would make, which kind of builds on Young's, is that he alluded to, is I think the value of publishing in a regional sense, because even if you can, you know, put your game in on Steam or in an app store, there will always be some subset of the world that you just don't get, right? You don't know what you don't know, whether it's cultural sensitivities, what types of messaging will attract folks, how to engage players on an ongoing basis. And so even if people say, hey, in my core geographies, I can handle this, there, I think, as we've seen with, you know, China, obviously often driven by regulatory, Southeast Asia, more so cultural and fragmentation, and then other regions, I do think we're gonna see people be more willing to say, look, I just don't understand this geo, and let me work with a partner there that has domain expertise. And so I think that's a trend that we will see moving forward.
That makes sense. So I want to sort of move on to our last section, which is suggestions and advice, right? There are some startups in the audience, and we talked about really talking to publishers early, right? And what advice would you have for a lot of startups that are ready with their products very soon? And let me also give you sub-questions, which a lot of times I get is, should I work with a publisher or develop my own capabilities, right? Which is a huge decision. Along with, if I go with the latter of working with a publisher, what are some of the criteria or some of the things I should look at to select a publisher? So if you could just go ahead, and Cedric, please.
Yeah, maybe the first advice is to think about that very early in the process. Very often we see, we had many studios we've met recently, and many of them are thinking a bit too late. Especially if you are taking the route of building your own publishing capabilities, which arguably you can complement with some regional support anyway, because it's hard to be a truly global company from one location in the world. So thinking very early stage, like we've heard before, looking at the publishers, they are not all the same and not all the same in terms of capabilities. So depending on your game genre and category and ambitions, you should really look into that. That's probably super important. And think about how making the pie bigger rather than, you know, purely the rev share component, which is very often the debate that studios have internally. So the question is, how do you make the pie bigger?
Yeah, totally makes sense. Cordel?
Just building on that, whether you develop capabilities in-house or work with a partner, I agree, starting to think about marketability early is more important than ever, right? Because there are so many games out there, the pool is so flooded, marketability is as important, perhaps more important, than elements, core elements of your game and your game design. And so we also develop games, and one of the first things you do before you start writing any code is you just mock up what you want the game to look like, and you run UA tests, right? If you can't get it into people's hands at a reasonable cost, then like you shouldn't spend $1 million to build it. And so whether it's internal or whether you go and talk to some folks and try and get a sense, I think product development now requires an understanding of marketability, and it should feed into what you build and how you build. I think that's one of the most important things about game development, period, today.
Right on.
Yeah, Young and Sed kind of touched on this too, but finding the right partner is critical as well, and that's why it's also good to start early. Young had a great point, like how a publisher markets their games or builds their community or does certain things, you want to make sure that they have the same culture, that they have the same values, that they're going to treat your game with the same respect they would their own. And so it really is important to find the right fit for whatever you're going to do. And that could take time. So you don't, just don't want to leave it until the end. You really want to find like that partner that you're super excited to work with, and they're super excited about your game and super excited to work with you.
Yeah, and if you do decide to work with a publisher, you do have to ask a lot of questions. Never believe the first intro like deck that you receive from a publisher. It's probably does not apply to your like specific project. You have to ask questions whether they will be able to cater to your needs, whether they understand your project, whether they have love for it. That's very important. You have to build a friendship. You have to be able to at least have a person, a single person, point of contact within that publisher to be able to talk on a more like honest basis, 24/7, being able to connect with that person, whether he's on vacation or whether he's on leave. You need to be feel secure about that. So that's very important. And yeah, I think that's it.
Yeah, that makes sense. So I think we're really in agreement that we have to start early, right? Which makes sense because at the end of the day, we're bringing the game to the players and the consumers, and you need to understand the audience from the get-go, which I think publishing allows you to do that, enables you to do that. But let's deep dive in the few minutes that we have on publisher, working with a publisher versus internal capability, which is a huge, huge topic and a discussion. If you could share some thoughts, if you were the startups, how do you go about thinking this through? What do you think?
How much money do you have? I mean, that's the first question.
Realistic, right?
Right, which is, you know, how are you capitalized? If this is your first game, your seed stage startup, you're still figuring out some things on the product side, you know, I don't know whether I would think hard about adding more complexity and developing an entirely second business at the same time. And I say that to myself because we've decided to do a little bit of everything, and it's complex, and they are different businesses. So one is how are you capitalized? What's your runway? And I think that's a place to start.
Yeah, the second one I would add is what do your game need to be successful? Are you in a, I don't know, hyper-casual type of game, or are you a PC MMO type of game? It's totally different in terms of team size and infrastructure, and what are your ambitions? Is it to be successful in a region? Is it to be globally successful? So depending on the game, depending on your project, you may not require the same thing, of course, on top of having the cash capabilities, for sure. But I mean, it's still a long way to go to build all those capabilities internally. So you need probably to start even earlier thinking about that.
Sure, sure. Paul?
I think what Cordel said is like manage your resources, but also do your own due diligence as to what publishing means and how that works for you. So it's still worth meeting with publishers to really and ask them what they're going to do for your game and get as detailed as you possibly can, because that'll give you more of an understanding of what you would need to build if you decided to take that on. That's obviously for those who aren't as familiar with that side of the business, people who have been in the development side in certain like companies where that was all just kind of handled for them, and they would like make their game and they would trust that their colleagues were going to take care of it and publish it effectively. Really familiarize yourself with what publishing means and what capabilities you would really need to build if you did it, and then that'll help you make that decision and look at your budget and see if you can take that on.
You're gonna finish that.
There are a lot of tools that'll help you do self-publishing. So if I ask that question to myself, whether I'm gonna self-publish or find a publisher, if I have my own game, I will look into self-publishing because I have the tools, I know that I would be able to have the control over what the project will look like when I present it to the audience. But if you don't have that energy or that capability, of course, you will need to look into publishing.
That makes sense. So we're going to wrap up a little bit. I think there's a consensus among anything. They think it's really important to start early, right? So what we encourage you to do, if you're thinking about it, it's never too early to start talking to publishers and understanding what it is, because ultimately you need to bring the game to the audience, right? So I want to leave you with this. I think the best start to place to start is I encourage you to talk to the four gentlemen here, because I think they not only represent some of the best in class publishing, but at the same time, best in class in their own regions as well. All right. Well, thank you. Good job,
thank you,
guys.
Thank you.
You know the deal.